giveaway. But in the meantime, there was a story in the Asbury Park Press yesterday about the time that Jon Bon Jovi was on the Giants sidelines during the 1990 football season, taking pictures with his hair tucked under his hat and sunglasses so that no one would notice. And the man who made that happen was Giants punter Sean Landetta, who joins us. How you doing, my friend?
I'm good, Steve. How are you, sir?
You know what's really cool about this? Back in the day, my mother had an autographed picture of Sean Landetta from like 1986, and it's signed to Aunt Ro. Love, Sean Landetta.
That's pretty cool.
All the way back then. Now the story goes, you were quite the player back in the 80s. You were in Page Six a lot. You know, you were always, you know, you were out and about. And how did you hook up with Jon Bon Jovi?
Well, back in the fall of 89, during that season, it was actually a Monday night. Back then in those days, the China Club was a real cool place to go in New York City. And on Monday night, that was kind of the night where, you know, a lot of the players from different teams and actors and celebrities would go. And one Monday night there, I went in and had a chance to meet him. A buddy of mine who worked there told me he was there and he was a big Giant fan and asked me if I wanted to say hello. And I did, and we talked. And, you know, that's when I discovered he was a really big Giants fan. And, you know, we talked, and I said, you know, I'd love to get you out to practice sometime. And I remember asking his girlfriend with him at the time, who now is his wife, Dorothea. I said, you think you'd want to come to practice? And she kind of laughed and told me, she said, Sean, he'd land his helicopter in the middle of Giant Stadium if he could come to practice. So I cleared it with Parcells, and he came up, and, you know, that was the beginning of a, you know, friendship that's now, you know, over 25 years. So, you know, a chance meeting and some conversation, and, you know, a year and a half after that, him and I are standing on the sideline of Super Bowl 25, you know, watching the Buffalo kicker getting ready to kick a field goal that would either beat us or lose the game. But great moment, and all these years later, good to rehash it.
Now, how about that? And you and John are still, he's such a great guy. I mean, you talk about a guy who gives back and who never forgot his Jersey roots. You got to go Jon Bon Jovi.
No, I agree. I mean, people know he does a lot. But if people really knew everything this guy does, mm-hmm. I mean, they'd almost be shocked because he's done so much for so many people. And his energy level is unbelievable. I mean, the way this guy tours, the way he trains, you know, he's just doing so many things. And, you know, he's had a great passion for football his whole life. And, you know, through the years since he got involved with the Giants with me, he's made great friendships with Parcells, Bill Belichick, and through them, you know, he's met a number of owners. And this past year, he actually was in the running to purchase an NFL team. So it wouldn't surprise me in the future if he ends up being a part owner of an NFL team. But, you know, besides being one of the greatest musicians ever, mm-hmm. you know, from New Jersey and the whole world, you know, guy's just a very generous guy.
Could you ever see Jon Bon Jovi, after seeing him on the sidelines at the Super Bowl, owning the Buffalo Bills? Like, wouldn't that be a contradiction?
Well, you know, I know about 10, 15 years ago, he bought the Philadelphia Soul, indoor football team. And he learned a lot doing that, and they won a championship there. And he got a taste of being an owner and everything that goes with it.
He did a great job with them, too.
Yeah, he did. He did. They won a championship.
Yeah.
They sold out. You know, he's a brilliant marketing guy. He understands how to do all that stuff. But I think he's been in talks with other teams, too. I think there's probably been some other discussions with other NFL teams about him being a part owner. But, again, it wouldn't surprise me in the future if that happens because of his desire to want to do that.
I could see him in politics as well, especially in Jersey. But I wanted to ask you is, now you do, I know, like, you've spoken at Allentown High School. You talk to the football team over there, and you do a lot of work with high school football. You know that we lost quarterback Evan Murray this week, who died from a ruptured spleen. And with all the work that they do, you know, to try to protect these kids and to protect these players from injuries, you know, you just can't get everything, and this kind of a freak accident can happen. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, first of all, it's tragic. I mean, I have a son that's 18, and you know, I just think of this young boy's parents, this young man's parents, how they must feel. And, you know, you talk about a spleen. I can excuse me, I can remember playing sports when I was younger, going to the doctor and telling me your spleen is swollen, I don't want you to play. And I'm thinking, I don't feel anything, I can play. But again, at that young age, you don't realize, you know, how that's something that could kill you. You know, you have an injury, a guy, kid walks off the field and he's okay, and then he collapses. I mean, it's just a terrible thing. But for the most part, they've made great strides, you know, in protecting players with equipment and practice techniques. But that all being said, unfortunately, this kind of thing can and does happen, and it's just tragic.
You know what? You're better off being a kicker, right? Because the kicker, right? The kicker is pretty much safe, right? The place kicker as well, but you were one of the greatest punters of all time, and you should be in the Hall of Fame. And I say that completely objectively, because you made punting a science. You were really an expert at it, if such a thing could be.
Well, I appreciate you saying that, Steve. I've been on the Hall of Fame ballot the last 5 years, and I don't expect to get in anytime soon. There's so many other guys that have been waiting to get in, but maybe one day in the next 10 years that could happen. But I certainly worked at it. I had great people around me, and, you know, was fortunate to be on some terrific teams.
Oh, you were. I mean, you really were. And also, as long as we're talking about elections, I know you know Donald Trump. What do you think? What do you think of the Donald?
Well, I think it's amazing what he's done. You know, at first, I think everybody thought it was a publicity stunt, but at first you couldn't think it would be possible. But now, who knows? Maybe if he's able to do half the things he talks about, he'd absolutely have a shot.
He continues to lead in the poll. Sean Landetta, I cannot let you go without asking your thoughts on this year's New York Giants.
Well, very disappointing the first couple games. I mean, it's amazing. In the history of the NFL, there's never been a team in the first two games of the season leading by 10 points in the fourth quarter and lose them both. 90-some mm-hmm. years. I mean, think about that. I mean, this team could be 3-0, you know, in an NFC East division that maybe 8 or 9 games might win it. Dallas with their problems and the slow start with the Eagles. I think the Eagles will still be a powerhouse. I expect them to beat Washington and get the 2-2 after their 0-2 start. But, you know, what a shame the Giants could be 3-0 right now. But there's still plenty of games left. And let's see if Victor Cruz can get on the field. He was saying he's going to play Sunday. Now it doesn't look like it. But they get that guy back, they really have a chance.
And also, Sean, spoken like an ex-Eagle as well on the Birds. Hey, my pal, I'm so glad that you came on tonight. It was so great to be able to talk to you. I know you were up in a plane, and it really, you know, we were lucky to get you. And thanks for coming on.
Thanks for having me, Steve. Thank you.
You got it.